Darling, over here!
Whatever's the matter?
Domnule, Chester! Let's get to the hotel. We'll find out what's going on there, I expect.
When I was young, there were times, I think, when I took myself just a little too seriously. I was a bit of a know-it-all, and I expect I could be rather boring to boot. But I did love, and I still believe that love has a wisdom of its own. No one in its grip can be completely bad. I was 21 in 1939, and war had just been declared. I arrived in Romania with a tall and not unattractive man at my side, Guy Pringle. He worked at the University of Bucharest. We met on his first summer holiday back in England, and we were married in less than a week. I thought I knew everything about my husband there could possibly be to know.
Buonasera, domnule.
Yes, hello, we have a room booked. Pringle.
Mr. and Mrs.
What's all the fuss about out there?
Dear boy, I really must take your telephone to make a most important call.
Yakimov.
I don't believe...
Guy Pringle.
Oh, but of course.
What on earth is going on?
I have no idea. There are rumours, of course. The king to make an address. Foreign troops massing on the frontier. The army to be mobilised. Hard to know what to make of it all.
Oh, I'm sorry, Yakimov. My wife, Harriet.
Dear girl.
Prince Yakimov.
Are we really at war?
Too soon to draw any conclusions. Best wait and see. My dear man, your telephone.
What a wonderful coat.
Yes, yes. Given to my poor old dad by the Tsar himself. Never wears out.
Come in. What's your role in all this, then?
On an absolutely vital mission, you understand. I'm a journalist now, you know. Yes, indeed. Reporting on these momentous events.
Well, Pringle. See you soon, perhaps.
Well, perhaps we could have a drink at the Athene Palace. Not such a bad place. Come
yes,
on, bar.
But I'm afraid I've already made an arrangement tonight. Dinner at Pavel's.
Pavel's? Oh, they do a very nice duck on a bed of asparagus.
Your kid on Pringle.
Thank you. Sorry, I can have to get a move on. Darling?
Shouldn't we wait and listen to the radio?
Oh, there won't be anything more than rumour and panic. We'll find out more at the restaurant when we meet the others.
But perhaps later then,
Yes, of course.
Oh, your hands are still cold from the train, little monkey paws.
Did you say Prince Yakimov?
That's right. Fallen on hard times.
Don't do Pringle! I forgot. You had many messages. A woman. She would not leave her name.
All right, thanks.
Someone must be anxious to talk to you.
That's mad here, darling. They haven't had the telephone long. People sit at home making telephone calls to complete strangers just for fun. Nice of Inchcape to ask us to dinner.
He must think a lot of you.
I don't know about that, but he isn't a bad sort. He runs the English department pretty much single-handed. Anyway, you'll meet him later. You can make up your own mind.
I will. I love you, Guy.
I know.
It's not normally as busy as this. Excuse me. Sorry.
I'd like to find anywhere to sit.
Guy!
Ah, there's Inchcape.
Hello. And you must be Mrs. Pringle.
Harriet. Hello.
Harriet. Welcome to Bucharest. I hope you're hungry.
What's all the excitement?
Florica's singing tonight.
Florica?
An entertainer and the mistress of the Minister of Information.
Who is sitting just over there with his wife.
And I thought Bucharest was going to be boring.
I'm afraid this is the best table I could find. I was told we were lucky to get anything in a time of war.
Hello, Guy.
Clarence, Harriet. This is my colleague, Clarence Lawson. My wife, Harriet.
So you've gone and got yourself married at last.
Scusat! Donnelly!
Have they all gone mad?
Don't you know? There's a war on.
Apparently.
Russians have occupied Vilnius.
You mean they're inside Poland?
It's a good thing if you ask me. They'll offer the country some protection from the Germans.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to leave you in the lurch at the university, Guy. You'll have to take over the English department. I've just been put in charge of British propaganda in the Balkans. An official appointment.
That's splendid.
But do you think we'll be able to stay here? In Romania?
Why ever not?
We heard some of the British women were being ordered home.
Impossible. Nothing of that sort could happen without my knowing it.
See, darling, I told you.
Ah, at last, something
Bravo.
To drink.
Here we go.
One.
I asked Sophie to join us here.
Sophie?
She called just before we left the hotel. She's very depressed about the war.
Harriet, can I pour you some wine?
Yes,
where did you
please.
Go this summer, Clarence? Did you take that bus journey from Beirut to Kashmir?
I got stuck in Beirut. I did think of flying home to see Brenda, but... I never got around to it.
I went to Rome, spent a lot of time in the Vatican Library. How was England when you left it?
Calm enough. Foreigners were leaving, of course.
Here's the lady now.
Do you think the minister's wife knows about her husband's affair with Farika?
Of course.
But the convention requires her to pretend she doesn't.
Oh,
here's your friend now.
Sorry. We won't have enough chairs.
She can have mine, I only come over to say
hello. Oh, do sit down, Clarence, and stop hovering there like some great moth.
Oh, what a night. The streets are so full of people. So frightened.
Darling, you must meet Sophie. Oh. Sophie, this is my wife, Harriet.
How do you do?
And there she was, a beautiful, voluptuous woman, full-bosomed and rippling with sexuality. It had never occurred to me that Guy might have known other women before me. But she was leaning across the table and he was kissing her cheek, and my jaw was just about to make an undignified descent into my lap when I pulled myself together and gave her my hand, which she squeezed unpleasantly in her bejeweled paw.
This woman, that's such a terrible thing.
Have a drink, Miss Orishano, and do try to cheer up.
I go to sleep thinking of it. I wake thinking of it.
Really, all that anxiety is simply a waste of time.
But I used to be a journalist. I worked for an anti-fascist paper. What if the Nazis come here?
Is anyone cold?
What? I am a bit.
I saw snow on the mountains this week. War will be over before we know it. The Germans have better things to do than spread their troops about all over Europe.
I expect at some time in your life you've seen a child at the dinner table determined to be the centre of attention, pointing, screaming, banging its fists. Well, Sophie Orishanu shared a great deal in common with such a child. She had a different arsenal at her disposal, but her objectives were pretty much the same. When her irritating babble no longer held everyone's attention, she switched tactics and played the helpless, sniffling female, dabbing at her nose with a handkerchief and reeling Guy in like some great fish. I got a kick to all the way to Transylvania.
Whatever is the matter?
Oh, God. It is nothing to be discussed in public.
Ah, there you are.
Good evening, Yakimov. Have a drink.
Most kind. Not that I haven't earned it. A journalist's life is not an easy one, but someone has to report on the momentous events of the day.
It is not so difficult to be a journalist, I think. But if the Nazis come here, I see...
The nasties, that's what I call them.
Yes.
Don't know what happened to them. They started out all right, but they overdid it somehow.
I imagine you were at Eton, Yakimov. Eton boys always have a way with understating things.
Alas, my poor old dad couldn't cough out. I went to one of those horrid schools where Marshall is beastly to Snellgrove and Debenham much too fond of Freebody.
As Yakimov entertained everyone, Sophie sat in a mood, no longer the centre of Guy's or anyone else's attention.
The old girl's Yorkshire Terrier in a duffel bag at the back of the organ loft, and it howled all through the second verse of Handel's Lark.
We really should go.
Darling, I don't think anyone wants to leave yet.
Florica will sing again, I'm sure, but later. I was hoping to have an early night. Oh, but tomorrow. You have all day to sleep, is that not so?
Come on, darling, have another glass of wine.
What do they say?
They're telling you they're hungry. Here.
Can the beggars tell your English just by looking at you?
Of course. Something you'll get used to.
How do you know, Sophie?
Oh, she's a sad creature, really. She gets in a bit of a state sometimes.
She certainly seemed upset tonight. Was it just about the war, do you think?
What else could it be?
Perhaps she's upset that you got married.
Oh, no. She gave up that idea ages ago.
So, she did want to marry
you? Her mother was Jewish. She worked on an anti-fascist magazine.
Oh, she wanted a British passport?
Well, I felt sorry for her. I didn't know you then. Friends of mine married anti-fascists to get them out of Germany.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.